Hi everyone, this is Sonali. Hope you're all doing well and staying safe. Welcome to the first episode of BX Academy, that is Business Excellence Academy on Mentoring and Coaching. This series is aimed at empowering business owners and entrepreneurs by providing them with the guidance and support they require towards achieving excellence in their businesses. Our goal is to take you step by step every week towards a successful business. And our first episode is on the principles of business excellence. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section, and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Sonali, and thank you for hosting this another series. We just finished one series for 30 episodes where we talked about how can we value businesses, invest into new businesses, scale the businesses, and also exit. This is a new series by Business X, which would be talking about how you can achieve business excellence. And we'll cover a lot of topics in this. It's also designed to empower business owners and entrepreneurs whenever they would like to bring excellence to their enterprises, especially targeted towards the small businesses and also a lot of startups. Because that's a community which we at Franchise India largely or Business X would really address. So we'll make this very interactive. So use your Q&A box and keep asking your question, and I'll pick up the question as you go along, or in the last part of the webinar, I can take all these questions. So in this series, which would start every Saturday at 11 o'clock, we'll pick up one topic. And there were 9 topics which I would really work on and talk about. These would be a mix of a lot of best practices which we see and we read and we have seen from, I think, particularly keeping India as a marketplace. Because sometimes we build a lot of content which is suited to other markets and might be right, because from broad viewpoint, the principles would remain same. But the challenges of sometimes Indian business owners can be quite different. Like we are seeing one challenge now, that the world is very differently behaving to this COVID, and we are behaving very differently. Our businesses are also behaving very differently. And the support structures we have in India versus we have in, say, UK or US are also very different. So it's a very difficult and different times, you know, where we need to really see that how we can still continue to run our businesses without having any external support coming to us. So it's a very unique situation to be in, that you need to find your own path and your own way to really come out of that. So I will pick up a lot of these best practices which would come in, and also take some of my own experiences, because I have also, in the journey of about 28 years, I've been working in business, and I've done a lot of businesses and also failed a lot of businesses. So a lot of learning come from my own self also in terms of what should be done in that. So, and this is also learning in the way, you know, so as every day passes, you know, I also am learning that what is the better way to do things. And this is a collective sharing of knowledge. So we'll talk about 9 topics. One is largely leadership. We'll talk about business leadership. We'll talk about strategic planning. We'll talk about the consumer focus and how to create consumer delight. We'll talk about the knowledge management, because this has become a very important aspect of business. We'll talk about the business intelligence, how business intelligence can help you define your path ahead. We'll talk about operational execution. We'll talk about team alignment and innovation. Especially these days, team alignment has become very a big issue, and innovation is a constant work. And finally, we'll talk about the sustainability of business model, because I am becoming a big fan of sustainability. You know, sometimes you have these curves, and they're sharp curves which comes in, and you need to really see how do you build a more sustainable business model. But today's discussion would revolve around business excellence. And business excellence is developing and strengthening the management systems and processes of an organization that it can create a better shareholder or a stakeholder value. You know, so there is a stakeholders for every business, not only the shareholders. How do we really create systems and management systems which can smoothly run the organization and achieve the goals which is set for it? And especially for, you know, these systems, you would see especially business excellence is well adopted in the large corporates. I mean, I in the morning was reading how Tata's have implemented business excellence in all their enterprises, especially Titan. I read a case study on that. And also I read about the institutes like Mahindra started an institute, complete separate institute, which is a business excellence institute, not only for their own enterprise, but now it also brings in a lot of learning to other corporates and so on and so forth. But when we talk about the business, small business owners, you know, these would not be really so well implemented, because their challenges can be very different. Their enterprise capabilities can be very, very different. Their organization strength can be very, very different. And entrepreneurs most of the time have to be involved themselves. So the three areas which concern every single business owner is really about growth, performance, and innovation. These are three very, very strong thinking, you know, which goes to every day you go to your business, you would have these three things. How do I bring growth to my organization? How do we bring better performance and monitor that performance? And how do I continue to innovate? One of the areas which I'm working these days is that I've become a big fan of this situation where, you know, people would normally would see in the conventional businesses, I would think that if I want growth, then I need to work harder than yesterday or do more of what I did yesterday to get growth, which means that I had to move, invest more in marketing, more in resources, more man hours. Everything has to be more than what I did yesterday to get the growth. Actually, it's a myth. That's not true, because at a certain level, you will exhaust all these resources and you will not be able to put more on that. And still you want the organization to grow. So it needs a different thinking. It would need what I call operational innovation. Unless and until you have to innovate every single operational structure of your company, that you are able to address the same problem, but do it better now. So you're addressing the same problem, which is the problem you started your business on, but now with innovation, you are able to address it better. If you are able to take those changes in your enterprise, then you will be able to. So which means that it's just not about the broader strategy, it's also about equally efficient execution, and the innovation in execution would really lay the entire thing. Sometimes we overdo on the strategy part of it, and we don't really understand the innovation we require in our execution processes. And if you really see in the last 15, 20 years of enterprises or companies which have done well, they've actually not really redefined the problem. They've gone and efficiently deliver the great execution on that, which is to me a more important aspect. And now we are also seeing one company to another company. Like yesterday, I was discussing with one of the big restaurant operators, and he says Zomato has significantly gone up than Swiggy in the last 1 year, just because they've been more efficient operationally to go and deliver the same. They are delivering the same product. They just pick up food from another restaurant and bring it to your home. And they probably would have similar kind of listings, but one company has outperformed the other one just because of their operational efficiency. So you really have to really see through that how you differently are improving your smallest of the processes and able to get a better execution. So I will now touch upon the 12 different points, which to me are very, very important when you're really looking at delivering business excellence. And particularly, again, designed for small and medium enterprises in mind, because to me, that's the segment which we largely address. The first point which comes to you is, how do you really monitor the performance itself? You know, and performance is divided into one is people, you know, people hiring, people deployment, and their 100% involvement. That's one part of the structure. So everybody wants that your team is not completely committed, but they're emotionally invested into the business. So how do you hire, how do you develop, and how do you get them 100% committed? That probably is the burning issue with almost every enterprise. And especially now, because a lot of things have changed. And it's become the biggest concern now. How do you really get the best out of that? But another part is, how do you monitor that performance? First, you define that performance, and then you monitor that. Now, we give all the examples of these tech companies which have great environments, great places to work. Almost all awards of best place to work goes to these companies. And when you visit these organizations, you find lovely environments and so on and so forth. And it feels like that how they are able to do it versus my own business. And a lot of business owners come to me and say, oh, there is a difference in terms of what they do. And actually, if you really see, they have a self-monitoring capability, right? So every person, even if he's working remotely, understands what he's not achieving. And that changes when you are looking for a small business. It's very instruction-based. You continue to really instruct. And whatever we do that, there is no capability for people to even know what they are expected to do. So there will always be gap on the expectation to from a management viewpoint and what is being delivered. And that would create not so much of what I call the holistic development of the talent, and you will never get their 100% involvement. Rather, there is a three stages of people involvement. Average companies, if you see mid-size or small-size companies, would have only 30% of their workforce really involved in the business. And what I call positively engaged in the business, 70% of them are either not engaged or actively disengaged, which means that they are absolutely not, they are negatively working for the organization to pull the organization down. So you really have a biggest challenge and pain point is how do you really get the performance right? And performance would all be based on these two aspects. How do you deploy talent and how do you monitor that performance which is coming in? I call that triple C. How you are concerned and how you care and how you connect with every single employee. And Surbhi asked a very important question. How do you win employees' trust in testing times? A very difficult answer to give, really, because there is no definite answer. And prolonged a situation like this, which is now 14 months, even the largest of the corporates, which have a very different approach to all these things, are behaving very differently. So, but yes, you can be, as I said, triple C, care, show your concern, and stay connected. That's the answer to it. And also a bit of transparency, because a lot of people appreciate where the organizations are. If you are transparent as an organization and you know what is going on and people know about your company, it also helps you to have a better involvement and better engagement. And not taking too extreme steps, you need to really be moderate in your structure. The second piece, which is very important for small businesses, especially, is there is something I'm reading on what I call the breathing organization. As a breathing organization, you need to be somebody who's actually getting a lot of input. You're open for listening. You're learning as an organization. That's something which becomes very difficult, especially when it looks like a small and medium enterprises, they have a resistance towards that. They are not a breathing organization. Even I think this is a problem lies in larger companies, or I would say the legacy institutions. They at a certain stage stop listening at all, and they don't know really what is going on. And that's why companies collapse, and they're not able to do that. Even one of my companies really was consistently growing for 15 years, never year-on-year growth, every time double-digit growth and so on and so forth. And a particular year, we realized with all the effort, which I said, I was putting more effort than what I did yesterday, and results were not coming because we didn't understand that there was a huge shift which already started to happen. People were not expecting what we were delivering, and they already are shifting. And so it was even more expensive to get them back. So that's something you need to really understand. So unless and until you are a breathing organization, you continue to understand and get a lot of observation inside the company in a good fashion and a right fashion. And you also have to have ability to ask right questions, and then only the right answers would start coming in. So second point is, how do you really build a breathing organization? That's very important. Third is create the larger vision for future. So this is a good time, actually. If you really ask me, most of the companies I'm advising these days, I said, rewrite your future now. Define what is looks like, and how sharp you are, very clear in terms of defining what is the future for the organization. And that's something sometimes if you have a little bit of run, you start becoming confused. You don't know how you define that. You just keep going. It's like just riding the tiger. You just don't have ability to understand that how do you really define the future. More you constantly go and define that future and continue to take within the stakeholders and they understand where we are going to, then only we will have. And the vision also have to be not too long. You cannot even predict what 5 years are, but you can predict what is the next 2 years are. So really define your piece. Fourth, which is my subject, which is what I do for a living for last 23 years. How do we build a repeatable system? In my business, it's called franchise. But anything you do, anything which you do, which can be repeated as a system, and create the same kind of consistent results, then only it becomes sustainable to me. And so unless and until you really design an organization or every single process of your organization, which can be repeatable and it can be easily trainable, and then only it becomes, rather I use this word called become an idiot proof. So if it will become the idiot proof, then that process really can be done. Because so that's also a very important part of achieving business excellence, that how do you really build a repeatable systems in the entirety. And especially for small businesses, we've done a lot of that. Sometimes very simple businesses, like look at a business like Ferns and Petals. It's just a flower shop, you know, but they have over the years found systems how to run efficiently a flower shop, and it became a repeatable system. Now they can duplicate that to 300 locations in the country. So that's something which is to me very, very important. Another area, which is fifth point, is really about defining what I call the business scorecard. Almost every month, rather than looking at your PL, people most of the times, they have that PL understanding, especially business owners. Any given point in time, you ask them, what is your profitability and what is your top line, bottom line, they would pretty much know it. While there would be some varies in that. But that's not really the answer of how your organization is doing. I've seen healthiest of the organizations in 2 quarters sink because they were not reading the other things around them. How do your financials is just one part of it. But how's your consumer experience is the second part of it. How your organizational capability is growing, that's another part of it. How you're actually getting performance of your entire organizational assets, which can be people and your capital or any kind of physical asset, how they are operationally performing for you. All these pieces together becomes what I call business scorecard. Unless and until you stop taking a PL and shift your focus on reading your business scorecard and rate yourself how you're growing in all these aspects. You can even take more aspects to that business, you know, and that would really come down to how you're performing. Sometimes you're just looking at the financial, and this problem happens with a lot of these large companies because they're represented on board, and board has a little bit of a flat eye on other things which are happening because that's not the part of their day-to-day responsibility. And they would look at and get excited about the financial performance of organization. And that's why we've seen a lot of companies which are financially very well performing at a particular stage, and they start not doing well because they didn't understand how the consumer was behaving, how operational capabilities were growing, how they were performing on all their organizational assets. Now, the sixth point is, how do we build sustainable improvement? You know, that's very, very important because the customers are going to change. Customer will continue to ask better, stronger, faster, and a cheaper product every time. You know, constant ask is, how do I get better, stronger, faster, and cheaper product? And now there is a new thing which is added to it, what you call, how do you reduce the inconvenience to the consumer? Continue to reduce that inconvenience. You know, like Amazon started with the delivery, it was, I can get you home, which is one convenience, but can I get faster to my home? Can you deliver even 30 minutes to my home? So which means that the constant eye for Amazon is to really deliver almost everything to the home. So they are adding on one side a lot of products which were not part of Amazon. And second thing is, how do I get faster to your home and more efficient to your home? So they would continue to do these things. And how do you really, and every time you need to measure that how I have moved up and taken little more inconvenience out of this whole process, little more inconvenience out of that. You might not be able to do that, but if you can do a partial improvement on that, if you were delivering something in 3 hours, can you deliver this in 2 hours, 45 minutes? That to me is your sustainable improvement. How do you continue to challenge every single thing and look at from a consumer viewpoint, how do you really want to bring a sustainable improvement to the organization? The seventh point is, how do you maintain momentum? You know, how do you really continue to run a momentum on your business model? How you are, every single thing is continue to push each other. And that's something which becomes even more difficult, and especially in these times, big problem. Because February, March, almost all organizations we were consulting, January, February, March started looking. Actually, January, February was looking very good. March end, it started changing because we had some news coming from Maharashtra and things of that nature. And then April started tanking again. And now again, to pull up this whole momentum, it took the full quarter of Q3 to bring a good quarter of Q4, which was looking like a good quarter, and now you're again in the dip, and you again to bring that momentum back, it takes some time. So now it is the business I'm advising is not about really about making big plans and pushing something and dieting. It's just continuity. You need to continue this and that thing, continue to see this, that your businesses and whatever you're doing has some kind of a continuity to do that. You cannot do this. So it is very important times to really maintain momentum. I feel that the biggest challenge today with almost every enterprise, every business leader is that how do you really continue to have the momentum going? Now, finally, is how do you make your organization, eighth point is how do you really make the organization as a thinking organization? How do you really use these three important aspects? One, experimentation. Almost everything which needs improvement needs to have new experimentation. Second, how do you bring observation? And third, business analytics. Everything can give you a good observation, but it is important to change how far we can change. That would come from stronger analytics. So if you can really, as a thinking organization, can bring this experimentation, observation, and analytic to your organization and never have a fear to implement that. Rather, I call the test and measure. Everything you do, test it, measure it, and if it is results is good, then just go out and implement it. So that's the way it should be done. Almost everything you test and measure. Don't wait for others to do. You know, you need to be a front runner for doing it. And we've seen almost all organizations which had experimented to improve the consumer experience. Eventually, it is all about consumer experience. If you ask why you exist, is because of your customer. And if you feel that I can improve something to my customer by experimenting something and it works well and you get the good observation and you analytically feel that it is a right fit. Another four fits I always advise, which you should use in an enterprise, any decision you're taking in your enterprise, always bring these four fits. What is it called? Strategic fit? Is it strategically right? Financial fit, which means that it is would not have any adverse financial impact on you. Marketing fit, which means that it speaks the same language which you as communicate to your audience. And operational fit, it should also be operationally within your capabilities to deliver. You know, you cannot bring that change, which is like, say, for example, I was running a food business and F&B business, and I wanted to experiment, but that experiment would mean change of menu, which means change of packaging, change of other things, and that would change my operational capability, right? Because I don't have that capability, and I will not be able to do it. Sometimes some observations, some feedbacks are great, but they're operationally not right for being implemented, right? So that's something which you need to really very consciously do that. And finally, the ninth point is about focus on process. How do you really focus on building every smallest thing which happens to your enterprise has to be followed as a process. There's an interesting saying which I read. It says, if you cannot describe what you're doing as a process, you don't know what you're doing. It's a very interesting saying. If you want to make notes, you can make notes on that. If you cannot describe what you're doing as a process, you don't know what you're doing. So this is very, very important aspect where almost everything which you run in the company, it can be very simple day-to-day system also has to be documented as a process and it's to be defined. And then, which goes because it's defined, you can clearly connect the dots. You can create the whole architecture of your business. And once it is done, the business can run without you. Otherwise, business owners, especially small businesses, they're always available to connect the dots because there has to be somebody who's just trying to connect that. And it is really heavy lifting because you are the one who's really doing all that. Now, another area which is very important, and this is what I would advise the startups, early stage companies, and this is a 10th point, is that you need to make 100% efficient product at the start. Now, a lot of thinking comes in saying, look, let me evolve as I go along and let me continue to improvement would happen, you know, every single thing from a business viewpoint. But when you're starting something, you need to be 100% sure that this was the best you can deliver at that point in time. And whatever the goal you set for. Sometimes half-baked structure, if you take it to the market, it just doesn't work. I mean, there is a very short window now left where somebody would accommodate your mistakes. A very, very short window. There is nothing which is available now. I feel that you are rejected almost instantly. So we've seen a lot of startups failing. A lot of startups failing because they have no, product was still in development and they took to the market. And that's something you should not do. You should even delay your launches or launch of your product or your commercial launch unless and until you're very, very definite on this. Now, 11th point is create larger consistency of your purpose. How do you, what purpose you started from? There has to be a consistency in that. Now, this also changes. I've seen that if you start a business and you started with some purpose, you wanted to have solved some problem, and that was a larger purpose, you started an enterprise, and 2 years down the line, 3 years down the line, it has changed. Like I was advising a lady out of Gurgaon, she started a design company, and later she became industrial because they put as a design company, made a factory. Now, because they put a factory, they want the factory to run 24 hours. So they are producing what people want. And suddenly they become from a design company into an industrial company. And the design side has gone backseat. And now they're only making sure they sweat out their machinery to produce more. Now the whole purpose has lost, and sometimes this is the difficulty which I see in companies because they start chasing financial goals because they have to pay the bills and the tariff, and they lose the purpose, which makes the organization anywhere more hollow because just driving hard to just sustain that organization where the purpose itself has been lost. And that's something which is very, very important to continue to remind yourself and create a little bit of consistency in terms of why you were there and what purpose you wanted to resolve. And finally, think about the customer. The 12th point is it's all about customer. How do you deliver great customer value efficiently, effectively, and consistently? How do you really deliver a great customer value effectively, efficiently, and consistently, and continue to measure that? So these are the 12 points. If you do that, you will be able to build business excellence. And this is something which we are more than happy to share with you. Also, if you are interested to get more information on this, or maybe a note which I have shared with you, I'll be more than happy to share with you. And also follow our series. This would be every Friday for 30 minutes. We'll talk about one topic every single time. And also happy to take your feedback, any feedback you would have or anything which fits into your business, you need more elaboration, we will be happy to do that. Over to you, Sonali.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for a wonderful session as always. It was very insightful and I'm sure it added value to our audience's lives as well. I know we have exceeded the time limit of the series, but will it be possible for you to take up a few questions in the end?
Sure. Let's go for a couple of minutes.
Sure. So the first question we have is how to create a growth plan when the situation at this moment is so unpredictable. My company created a plan in the start of last quarter, aiming for excellent growth, thinking this COVID situation was about over. But now it has hit us again and all plans are now looking unachievable. How to cope with this?
This is very unpredictable. This can happen to... This is first time it has happened to almost all businesses. I mean, this statement can go with everybody possibly, but you can only say what stage of maturity you are. If you are a business which is at a certain stage, then obviously you have a different impact. If you are a mid-size and if you are an early stage, you will have a different kind of impact. At this stage, I would say early stage companies are better off because you have no... You can just say, I am delayed by one quarter or I'm delayed by two quarter. And if the purpose of your enterprise still is going to be relevant, which I'm sure, because if you've started something, you would be thinking something which is relevant for the next 5-10 years, which means that you're not losing much. And rather use this time to do that. I see a bigger problem with companies which at a different level, they cannot even stop. They have to continue to run. They are the ones who are in a deeper problem, and they would have sometimes unrealistic advantage to their competition to take their market share. So those would be bigger challenges. But if you are in an early stage, I think you can really use this time to do what we discuss, build your capacities as business excellence, write every single process of your enterprise. So when you are back and starting the entire piece, you're better off and you're able to do a much faster scale than you would have done now. So it's a good time to be a little on the business rather than in the business. So think over it, design your business, write every single process, define your micro goals. And whenever this time becomes, let's start looking this, or maybe we start seeing the new tip going up, start putting in your growth back and scale back.
Absolutely, sir. The next question we have is, how would you define business excellence? Is it based on year-by-year growth or financial growth or brand improvement or something else, in your opinion?
As I said, business excellence, I've run through all the points. It can be, and it's largely to achieve your business scorecard, matched with your the larger business vision. And if you're able to do that, so business excellence is actually every smallest parameter of your business performance, and see that they can continue to improve, and it's all driven by systems and processes, and that's something which is, to me, an effective business excellence.
Another question we have is, how to grab the audience's reaction to my product, since it's a really good good quality product, but I cannot compromise on price. It's a new product, hence struggling on achieving the hype among our customers.
You know, I have to go into a little more detail in terms of what your product is and who you're trying to address, who's your target group, where it is available. Like I'm advising these days, a new brand which is coming in a black tea. You know, black tea looks like a very common thing, but actually we don't have genuine black tea in India, which you can drink it without milk and without dyeing. Now, the demand is already there. There's a conscious customer who doesn't want to have dairy or a vegan or something like that, and also prefers this. And there is a shift customer which is drinking green tea, but wants to drink black tea, can convert from green to this because green doesn't have that maybe the taste which we all like as Indian tea drinkers, because we've grown up on the regular teas. Now, that's very... But the problem is, where do I find them? You know, where these customers exist, how can I go closer to them, and how do I encourage them to attempt me? That's the answer we have to solve. Sometimes you have a great product, but you're not able to define very sharply your target group. And more importantly, what is the reason why people would shift wherever they are? So which means that I was using something, not that I was waiting for this tea to come because I was not drinking tea for the last 5 years because I was waiting for this to happen. I'm drinking something somewhere. How do I shift from where there to this is a bigger problem to ask. And that's something which business owners should really focus and define.
Absolutely, sir. The next question we have is, can you please elaborate more on the quote you said, if you can't describe what you're doing as a process, then you're not doing anything.
No, yeah, so it's actually about every single process in your business. And most of the smaller businesses or mid-sized businesses are very instruction-oriented, right? So everything is get done this, get done this, get done that. But this is not defined as a process. And so it means that talent is not trained on that process. So because if it is not defined, you'll always be in a certain amount of challenge, not able to address that. So every smallest piece in your or your business, it can be simplest of the things, can be defined as a certain process. And it can be internal stakeholders, external, to consumer, to vendor, to any other stakeholder in the business. Any kind of a process has to be very well defined and named. And then it becomes much easier to ride on that.
Right, sir. And finally, the last question of the session that I would like to take up is, how to win your employees' trust in such testing times?
Yeah, I answered that for Surbhi. I think she asked that question. That I answered. So it's about the three C's which I said: care and show your concern, and also look at, I don't know what it is, the third C. I see my notes and it was scare and stay connected. Yeah, so that was the third series. So good. Thank you very much. Thanks for joining in today. This is a part of our series, Franchising, that does a lot of knowledge webinars, opportunity webinars. And Sonali is part of Business X. Business X is a platform which helps you to raise capital. If you're looking for raising capital or building business valuation, we have a valuation team. And also, we have a business resale team, which means that if you're not willing to continue your business and you want to exit that business, that also helps. Franchise India, obviously, by name, it says that it is a franchise organization, helps you in franchising, growing your business through franchising. And also, if you're looking to buy a franchise, that also there. And then we have another company called Entrepreneur. Entrepreneur is the largest entrepreneur ecosystem in India. So please go and subscribe these channels. There are a lot of content available for business owners, and we'll continue to bring fresher content to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much once again, Gaurav sir, for a wonderful session. And thank you to our audience for joining us today. As Gaurav sir said, this is a weekly session. So we would see you next time, next Saturday at 11 o'clock for a half an hour session. And thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for again answering all the questions very patiently. And if anybody has any questions at all, please feel free to reach out to me and I would be happy to take up your questions. Anything you would like to say in the end, sir?
I put my email ID also. It's gm@gauravmahara.com. If you have any questions for me or anything which you want me to also further define, please send me a quick mail and I'll make sure that I send back the reply and answers to you. Thank you very much. Please take care of yourself and be safe. And but constantly keep your mind working, positive thinking, and also think about your careers and your growth of your enterprise, because that's what we are born to do. You know, that's what we need to do. While all this would settle sooner or later, but we need to really think about how are we going to grow our businesses and enterprise. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, everyone.